So good afternoon, everybody. My name is Ruben Flores Marsan. I'm the moderator for this panel this afternoon. We're joined via teleconference by Drs. Carmen Concepcion from the University of Puerto Rico and Ibis Garcia from the University of Utah. We have another panelist coming in. His name is Federico Del Monte. Federico works with the Department of Housing in Puerto Rico, and he used to be an assistant secretary of housing down there. In my capacity, I used to be the president of the Puerto Rico Planning Board during the term of governors Julio and Aníbal Aguilar. Also, planning director for the city of Providence in Rhode Island. And I'm currently a town planner, planning director for the town of Ware, Western Massachusetts. And in my spare time, I'm doing my PhD in regional planning out of the University of Massachusetts in Amherst. So thank you all for coming in this Saturday. It's kind of like raining, but we're here nice and fuzzy. So we're just gonna get started. And if Carmen and Ibis, can you give a little bit of your background to the audience? That'd be great.
Go ahead, Ibis.
Hello, everyone. Again, my name is Ibis Garcia Zambrana. I'm right now an assistant professor at the University of Utah. I actually conduct research with the Puerto Rican diaspora, in particular with like Puerto Ricans in Chicago. I was a co-chair of the Puerto Rican Agenda, and this is a group that has organized like community development and planning in Chicago. And they have also done some efforts in order to like receive evacuees from the islands and also like getting funds as well to be like distributed to different municipios. I'm right now like writing actually like a book on like the Puerto Rican agenda and their community building efforts. And this is what I will be talking mostly today, since like the hurricane being now at the University of Utah, I have been organizing a collective of planners, and it's like planners for Puerto Rico, and it is like composed of like people from like the American Planning Association, the Associates schools of planning, collegiate schools of planning, I should say, the Urban Institute, FEMA, but also the Center for Puerto Rican Puerto Rican Studies, and we have identified several things that we want to work on, from like providing technical assistance in Puerto Rico, and obviously the University of Puerto Rico also is part of this, to like conducting studios in the islands for communities in need, and just like so studios like planning assistance and also advocacy as well, and I'll talk a little bit more about those things, but I think that would be a good introduction of myself.
Thank you. Carmen.
Okay, hello everybody. My name is Carmen Concepcion. I am professor and director of the Graduate School of Planning of the University of Puerto Rico. I have a PhD in planning from the University of California at Berkeley. And before coming to Puerto Rico, I had the opportunity to teach at San Diego State University and at the New School for Social Research. But I have been here for the last 20 years teaching, and in the last 5 years being the chair of the department. My area of work is environmental policy, and provided me an opportunity to work with many communities on environmental justice issues and protection of natural areas by community groups. In fact, I have recently finished co-editing a book on the title is Environment Environment and Democracy, where we look at different experiences of community groups taking care of natural areas in different different regions in Puerto Rico. What else can I say? Well, I think that gives you at least an idea of some of the things I have been doing. And in the last 5 years, I have been concentrated on administrative issues. But in addition to that, I have been able to organize a lot of conferences and bring people from different places to come here and facilitate this kind of exchange between our faculty and faculty from other places.
Thank you, Carmen. So we got a few questions to ask for the summit, and I'm just going to start ahead and ask you, since you're the person on the ground, Carmen.
I'm sorry. Can you repeat that?
You're the person that is currently in Puerto Rico right now. So if you could tell us a little bit about what's going on in Puerto Rico in terms of community planning, how are the communities basically, you know, braving the aftermath of the storm? What's going on in the island? What are they working on?
Well, most of the work at the community level, I would say it's on their own. It's more voluntary. One of the things that I see that hasn't happened is that communities and local governments either has been part of the planning and decision-making process. The decision-making process has been centralized both at the federal level with FEMA and the military on the one side, and on the other side, the governor of Puerto Rico and his closest staff. And so the communities have been doing a lot of work, I think, that has been critical for moving Puerto Rico forward, but they hasn't been in the decision-making process or in the planning process, which is very unfortunate. And that is something that we have to pay attention to and look for ways into which this can change.
Okay. Are there any particular specific tasks that the communities are working on, or is it depending on their basic needs?
I would say that, well, some of the affected communities are working on particular needs that they have, but there are also nonprofit groups that are providing support and are collaborating with these groups. And so they work in whatever capacity the communities need to be supported.
Excellent.
Like, for example, one case that is very popular, very, very well known, is the Proyecto Enlace del Caño Martín Peña. And these people, you know, had a very difficult situation after the storm, and they were able to clean the area and do a lot of things to keep going because of the collaboration of so many organizations that went there to help them. And that has been one case in which not only the affected communities participated in all the process, but the collaboration from other community groups and organizations has been important for that.
So let me ask you one thing, Carmen. Have the organizations, you're pretty much talking about nonprofit organizations, or has the private sector also being invested in working with the communities?
There has been some action from the private sector too. Raising money, providing supplies. It has been a very big effort, you know, from the civil society. So I can say that. So there has been also investment and collaboration from the private sector too.
Okay, and let me ask you, Carmen. So as the communities try to move forward with their own particular needs, are they also getting into, you know, planning for a long-term vision of their own communities, so the communities are better than what they used to be before Maria, or that hasn't taken place at all?
Well, I would say that we are still in the emergency stage. We haven't resolved all the situations that should be resolved. So we are moving into recovery, and then probably a phase of rethinking where are we going and what would we would like to do. And so some of the communities are focusing on particular situations that they had and how they will be able to do something different, especially, you know, we are a month away from starting a new hurricane season. So people are very much aware that we are still in pieces and we don't know what will happen in the near future. So people are starting thinking about general needs that they think that will make a difference in preparation for the possibility of another phenomenon of any kind.
Okay, so if you could establish sort of a priority at the community level, they're mostly working first on housing rehabilitation, food systems, energy. What would be your opinion on that?
Housing is a very big challenge. Mm-hmm. You know, right now there are many people living together because there are not enough housing, or the condition of the housing is not acceptable for people to live. So housing is a very big issue. There are over 20,000 families without access to electricity. Mm-hmm. These are the numbers of PREPA, so it could be more. But at least we know that 8 months from Maria, there are still people without electricity and without some of the basic services.
Okay.
So those are the kinds of things that, you know, electricity is the major thing here. Many communities are working on how they can organize themselves to face a new phenomenon without having to go through the problems we have had with electricity. So some are talking about small grids or different kinds of options to provide for that. But those are two major areas, electricity and housing.
Okay.
Yeah.
Excellent, thank you. Ibis, so what are we in terms of the Puerto Rican planners in the diaspora? How are we sort of collaborating to help out communities? If you can shed some thoughts on that.
So since middle of October, when there was like the conference of the Associate College Schools of Planning, mm-hmm. there was like a round table, and then a lot of people like sign in to be part of a listserv that will share like news about what's going on in Puerto Rico, but mostly also maybe opportunities of like what people could do, like for example studios and technical assistance. So there has been like a smaller group, as I mentioned, just like that involves the American Planning Association, Urban Institute, Centro University of Puerto Rico, and other groups that have been like meeting monthly and just like looking at what is the making like a capacity inventory of like what everybody could contribute and bring to the table. So part of the idea is like the Urban Institute is right now like searching for funds to be able to create a hub that is combined with the University of Puerto Rico. So they have put like proposals, I will say like about like 2 months ago, and they're still like trying to find funds for that. But we know that that recovery is going to take a while in Puerto Rico. So again, we're like, those things are happening, but they will take time, right? And that hasn't been established yet. The American Planning Association has been, or actually like from Irma and Maria, they started like a foundation, and they like raised $53,000. So it's not like, it's not a lot, but it's supposed to be for planning. And it, right now, like they actually have like a call for proposals. And you can look for that in the American Planning Association. The call for proposals ends in like June 18th. And the idea is that people who are like planners, but you don't have to be a planner, you just have to have like a planning idea, and you have to get together with planners, right, in order to like pursue these funds. And then again, they're like small grants that you can do like community engagement. So that's like one of the, what the focus, just like concentrating in small neighborhoods or communities that are in need and having conversations about planning for the future. So that's one of the things that they want to fund. They also want to fund like if you are a planner and or if you're conducting some kind of like community development, or maybe you're in a nonprofit, but you're dealing with like issues of recovery and you need some training for dealing with like disaster recovery in particular, maybe learning more about FEMA, whatever that might be. They also pay for travel and for training for you to be able to prepare yourself. And those kind of like the two major things that they're funding. So again, that's like something else that they have been doing. And there's other things like, of course, that El Centro is like doing with the University of Puerto Rico, and Carmen can probably talk a little bit more about the conference that that it will take place in June 15 in Puerto Rico. I don't know if you like people in the, know that Edwin Melendez, actually the executive director, is a planner by training. So there has been that connection as well with El Centro. So right now it's again, the things are kind of slow because there will be some and the connections have been more like, you know, like you meet someone and you talk to somebody else and things happen on the ground, which I think that is a great thing that also or like what the center is doing just is great, which is like making networks and connection between people. So they establish these networks, even though it might be more informal, but then come together through a particular forum that might be El Centro or Planners from Puerto Rico, which is this group that I have been talking about. So if people want to learn more about it, so we have like a listserv, maybe get information to Ruben later to seek for particular opportunities in terms of, again, technical assistance or studios and things like that.
Thank you. Thank you, Ives. So we're just joined by our good friend, Federico Del Monte. Federico, like I said before, works for the Department of Housing and Community Development in Puerto Rico. He used to be Housing Undersecretary under Governor Aníbal Acevedo Vila. And I'm just going to let him talk a little bit about, you know, your situation in Puerto Rico, you know, all the challenges and the different opportunities that have arisen from Hurricane Maria, what you guys are working on the grounds that, like, you and Carmen are the ones that are actually in the island, and you can tell us a lot about it. So, Federico, pleasure to have you here.
Thank you, and thank you to the Dr. Melendez for invitation. My name is Federico Belmonte. I am planner and architect, and I work with the housing department. And here more in the role of vice president of the Puerto Rico Planning Association. Thank you. The advantage to speak to the aim of activity is that a lot of idea has been exposed. But in one note I take, I see from the community planning point of view, in Puerto Rico, we are in a crossfire. We have the debt problem of the government. And for the proposal in social service, in educational, and school closed, and this is a big problem. The other crossfire has been the Hurricane Maria. It's important to remember that the first aid to community come from the same community, and that is important because the community that better respond to the hurricane were the community that has some community organization, and that is important. At this moment, the big question is about what going to happen with the government and the debt. Because at the moment in Puerto Rico is no budget approved for education, for health, and it's a big question mark what going to happen. And the principal point is that we need to accept the fiscal plan because it's the only way that some negotiation to cut the debt can be accepted by the courts. And this is the, in Spanish, sin nudo gordiano. Mm-hmm. You need to accept that because it's the only way that you can have some hope that the debt can be cut. This is the problem. In the other way, the fund from HUD and FEMA, from the recovery of the country, can be a good opportunity to promote some new kind of model of development. But the problem is, at this moment, is the process is top down. We need participation from the community. And how the community are in trouble with the all the situation. For example, the planning society asked to help give time to community to a week ago, more or less, the housing department is public, the action plan from CDBG fund. Mm-hmm. But we are asking, is necessary to give more time to community to react to the document. And this is a struggle in this moment between the community and the housing department about to have much more time. I think that is for diaspora and for us, it's very important to have the diaspora for political support. Before backup, it's very important. Do a connection between projects and necessity and resource. Very important point. And for me, it's very important to defend the University of Puerto Rico. Central for Puerto Rico that the education for young people, for poor people, do not be closed or difficult. For me, it's very important. And the community and the people are in the process of organization. The people is in the street. The people is protesting. But we need more backup because it's a big reto challenge for Puerto Rico at this moment.
Mm-hmm. Okay, excellent. So let me ask you, Carmen, how can planners in the diaspora collaborate with
all your efforts with the Puerto Rican Planning Society and the different planning agencies in the island, because obviously there's a geographical difference, but also distance, but also there's a communication distance, in the sense that there's a lot of information that here in the mainland we're getting, but that is not being necessarily validated with what's happening on the ground. How can we ensure that, you know, our efforts up here in the mainland US are aligned with what's needed on the ground? Could you share some thoughts on that?
Yeah, well, that's a difficult question to answer. First of all, in terms of information, information here is weak. We don't have strong information. That's a major problem. And sometimes even what it is provided as official information, there are changes over time. Having said that, we have to deal with whatever we have available, especially as planners. You know, we have to deal with the information we have. In terms of collaboration, one of the ways in which that can be facilitated, at least that was the idea, was the network, the platform that Ivis discussed at the beginning when she was asked about what this project entails. And because at the beginning, I got many emails and calls for people asking for collaboration, and it's very difficult, you know, for our program is a small program, to be able to channelize all that. So that's why I asked for a platform where people can go to, where there will be like a list of projects and things like that, that people can look at them. And there are different ways, of course, of collaboration. There are people who are more interested in developing particular projects or in working with communities in their particular needs on a more general kind of project. But there are people who talk about the possibility of doing courses, practicums, and things like that. So there are different kinds of possibilities where how this collaboration can be structured. And I still believe that the best way to go is through this platform that has been established, because, you know, all people who are there, as Avis mentioned, a variety of planning programs, but also organizations, and that's a way to structure some specific collaborations.
So let me ask.
Ruben, I will add, just like if you have a sheet and you pass around a sheet to the people who are in the audience right now, I can add them to like this listserv, but also like Centro is creating a platform, it's like through Facebook, by having like communication by different working groups. And I must apologize because you know, we academics, it's like we our crazy ending of the semester, so I haven't set up the Facebook page, but this is like part of the goal. So if you guys can put emails, we can like set up a Facebook page through Centro as well and have those different kinds of platforms. And as I said before, we have a smaller group that also meets in phone calls like every month, and it's a great way to share opportunities and also like ideas and just sharing what's happening with FEMA, with like just like different organizations. So that will be the best way to be connected. If you're here, just like pass around the email. And of course, I know that Centro is doing this, so we can also convene in person. But part of the idea of Centro is like, we have that intermediary conversation, right? So we meet, this is the platform in where we meet, and then we have these smaller working groups through Facebook. Mm-hmm. email and then video discussion. I think that we do this like also through Zoom when we meet once a month, just to keep going that communication.
Okay, thank you. So Federico, let me ask you one question. Is there any type of community planning work happening in the community, like design charrettes, feasibility studies, vulnerability assessments that you know of?
Yes. For example, the last month of March in the School of Architecture, the School of Planning, and the center developed a workshop in the School of Architecture. For example, Architect Manuel Bermudez, that is my right, was in the process. That was a very exercise when we were with Santurce, Joven Torre, Playita, we were with Canovana, Loisa.
Okay.
And they did a very interesting project. For me, that is important is to show that there is another model to promote urban redevelopment, community development, that is not only the official action, because the government see the problem like a construction problem. Yes, the construction is part of the problem, but the problem is not a problem of construction, probably a community development, the resilience, and that we need it to show alternative model. And the diaspora, you have the content, you have the information about other way, can be a very important actor to put all the model over the table and say, there are another way to do community planning, to do design, urban design. Mm-hmm. And this is important to show to community other alternatives. Mm-hmm.
So let me ask you forward on that. So folks at the government level, Puerto Rico planning board mm-hmm. and all the different instrumentalities, they're seeing the problem from a public civic works point of view rather than from a comprehensive planning holistic model, incorporating resiliency, you know, renewable energy, microgrids, food systems, and all that. So what's the role of, planners outside government in trying to work out those differences, like the Puerto Rican Planning Society, the architects, the engineers, how are these folks collaborating to have kind of like a front to get to, my old place, the planning board, and say, hey, listen, you need to consider this, and we need to make it happen because we need for Puerto Rico to be better than what it used to be before Maria. That's the whole point behind the investments. So
I think the problem is to professional level, there is clear about the alternative model. But the problem, and I am Sandra Rodriguez, a newspaper person, is here because we need that this discussion go to the public level. That is not a discussion between architect, planner. We need elevate this discussion to the public level and to educate and discuss about other vision different to the government about the problem, and to educate the community about this. That, again, is not only a construction problem. And this is the point of view of the architect, the planner, community leader. The people need the house, but education, need health, need public transportation, need work. We are in process to elevate the discussion to the public level to push the government to hear the community, to hear the planet, to hear the diaspora. And in this effort, your support is very important.
So I got a question for the three of you. It seems that the planning process doesn't have a leader right now, and that there's some discussion in regards to who's in charge in terms of planning. Is it the Puerto Rico Planning Board? Is it the municipalities? Is it the same old players? Is it FEMA? Is it the Puerto Rico Fiscal Oversight Board? Who's in charge here? So, Ibis and Carmen, you have some thoughts, and then Federico, please.
Yeah, well, one thing that I would start saying is that, looking at it on the positive side, that Hurricane Maria has given planners an opportunity to bring the planner's discourse back in place. For many years, planning has been done by different specialists, very few planners. That has been our story. But with Maria, for different reasons, especially because of the intervention of federal agencies, when they ask questions about planning, I have been even asked at the beginning whether there were many professional planners in Puerto Rico, because all these agencies coming together, when they were talking about planning, there were very few planners or none in the groups. And I said, no, there's a lot of planners in Puerto Rico. Our school have graduated over 800 planners. At least half of those should be around somewhere. So that's a main problem. And for now also, the planning board, I had a conversation with one of the collegiate board the other day, and she's acknowledging that now people are turning to the planning board to say, well, because you're supposed to be in charge, you know, how we are going to do that. So slowly, it's a very slow process. There is a realization that planning has a lot to offer, and that we should be part of the process. And at least I try to look at those situations as positive, but there's still a lot to do. We are having a symposium next week, and part of the conversation will be about the role of planning in Puerto Rico and what planners can offer to all these processes, and the fact that there is something called disaster planning that we need to pay attention to. So I have been seeing this as an opportunity for us to push the profession and the planning activity in Puerto Rico. But there's still a lot to do. You know, we are just beginning in that process.
Okay. Ibis.
I have to agree with Carmen. So this is like a great opportunity to like bring people together, because as you said, Ruben, there's a lot of different players, and there has been like players like for example, the American Planning Association. It hasn't been that present in Puerto Rico, but again, it's a great opportunity to have that interest and build something. So the Puerto Rico doesn't have actually an American Planning Association chapter, right? So there's not a place where there's these types of conferences that happen every year, like they do in like the majority of places in the States, and also like have people dedicated again to bringing forums, but advocating for planning. So maybe there's an opportunity for a new organization, or maybe an APA chapter. And again, like the things that are happening are pre-organic, right? So they need a little bit more formalization, but I hope and I trust that that will happen a little bit with time. And as you were like phrasing the conversation, Ruben, about like, you know, who is in charge. I think that, you know, it's not about like someone being in charge, but like who is like maybe like convening, right, and facilitating this discussion. And right now there's like different places that's happening. So I think that there's great opportunities actually from the University of Puerto Rico being like one of those conveners, also like Centro, But again, maybe it's like creating a new APA chapter. So I don't know like where that will go, but those conversations are happening, right? It's a matter of like formalizing things maybe a little bit more. But collaborations are happening. So even though there might be not a clear bus, I don't think that we necessarily have to have that.
So perhaps we don't need to reinvent the wheel since we have the Puerto Rican Planning Society and one of the members of that chapter. I'm also a member of the American Plan Association and the American Institute of Certified Planners. So I think it's a matter of, you know, making the most out of what happened here, and this is a lemonade, and we make it sweeter or not. It depends on us in working together. So I know that there's in the audience, we have the president of the Puerto Rican Planning Society, and Federico is also a secretary, correct? Vice president. So, you know, I think it's a matter of, you know, putting these folks together during the conversations that we're having during the following weeks, you know, something that they're amenable to. Now that there's going to be grants in place, so communities can get trained and all that. Perhaps you and I can help out bridge that gap. I'd like to ask one question. So with the folks in Puerto Rico working so hard to bring everything together and us here in the mainland trying to, you know, our best, the few resources that we have to put things together so we can help out and be part of the contribution so Puerto Rico becomes better. What's the role of El Centro in continuing to foster that collaboration? If you have any thoughts on that.
So I think that Centro is already doing a lot of things, like this platform, also like the conference in Puerto Rico, having like the Facebook groups in where we can connect specifically in community planning. So again, that's not set up, but it will be like set up very, very soon. So the other thing that Centro is doing that I think are major research points for planners is number one, just like the GIS analysis of like just like the areas that have been affected and where the fund is going for FEMA. So I knew that Centro has put some reports on that, and it's like getting out of GIS data. So right now, and I'm maybe, you know, you the Planning Society knows a little bit more, maybe Ruben, about like where the GIS data is, right? And if there's like a centralized place in where people can share this GIS data. So I don't know if that's something that Centro could further as a goal, right? Because a lot of the data analysis are like obviously based on GIS or any data or clearinghouse that we can have for people to access. I think that they will be really, really great. So that's like an initial thought. I already know that Centro is doing that. And also Centro is like doing a lot of analysis in terms of like people who have been leaving the islands in terms of population and the movement to the diaspora. So maybe like a research piece surrounding maybe in the diaspora. I know some people are looking at to see like what people will need to come back if they were going to come back. I know that Charles Venator, it is in the Connecticut, I want to say area. He's doing a research like that. But if it was something that we could do, for example, in Chicago and in other places, to see how people could be facilitated or what people will need to actually go back to the island. Or maybe just more research surrounding that idea of like the diaspora and just learning more about that area. But also another piece I will say that I think that Centro has done research as well is in terms of the people in the island. So there's a lot of like elderly adults, and there have been a lot of impacts to the economy. So maybe doing more analysis regarding like the population lost, and also just the maybe like the labor economy that exists in Puerto Rico. Maybe again, more research reports in terms of the economic impacts. I think that those would be like really great. I know that Centro is like mostly concentrated in Puerto Ricans in the US, but having some analysis on the island itself, I know that Centro already has been doing that, but maybe facilitating a little bit more of those analysis of impact in general and population demographics, I think would be really great.
So Federico, following on.
I agree with Iris, and at this moment, David Carraquillo, president of the Puerto Rico Planning Association, has been working with the center, and all information that David and the Puerto Rico Planning is pick up in Puerto Rico about the disaster are put in GIS, and we are they are doing some information level for community can access to the GIS system and can see the problem in the community, and that is the level of information that are working now, and the thinking is to put to the position of the all people in Puerto Rico to have access to computing and to have all information about the plan project related to the hurricane with federal money to have available information to help in the discussion and in the proposal of solution.
Will that information be available to academic scholars like ourselves in the United States?
All information that we have is going to be available to whoever asks for it.
Okay, all right.
The only topic is the platform in which we will do it. In the center, that's maybe the place that it's going to be, because it becomes very complicated with legal issues.
Yeah.
We as a.
So you want to join us in the table, David?
Yeah, come on over. Yeah.
So, David Carrasquillo, right? Yeah, have a seat. David Carrasquillo, right?
Yeah.
Awesome.
Well, it becomes really complicated because of data culture in Puerto Rico, because there's a culture of. And there's a culture of privatization of public data. And there's a lot of information that we've signed contracts with different agencies. But we as a society, we've decided that we're gonna ignore those contracts. So we're waiting on anyone to sue us. I'd love today to sue us in some grounds of making public border information, mm-hmm. But yeah, every information that we have, we're gonna make it available in order to keep growing the analysis with overlaying that information. Mm-hmm. At the moment, we already shared the owner's data from FEMA, mm-hmm. on everything that FEMA recollected except names.
Correct.
Social
right.
Security.
Right.
So we actually have in a block level, mm-hmm. the information of destroyed houses, the amount given, and we already have some things that we should write about, because the formula that FEMA is using to get that on met needs number, mm-hmm. is really questionable. Mm-hmm. In some cases, we actually have block groups that have negative unmet needs, even though you have hundreds of uninspected houses. Mm-hmm. So you know that the data is not really reliable, mm-hmm. but you can do decision making on top of it. So I'm addressing the original question. Centro is already doing so much for the process, because at the policy level, you're making a guide of how the funding is gonna get to each of one of the programs. At a technical level, you're helping us making analysis and processing all this information. We have a lot of work ahead of us, because although we have already made the natural maps on many of the data,
right.
we need to do that at every municipal level or even community level. Mm-hmm. yesterday or 2 days ago, I lost track of time, published the action plan for CDG money on housing. So we need to map those projects and compare that with the damages from the FEMA data.
Okay.
I know that they're not gonna match. So that is a task of informing people of what's happening, where is the money gonna be allocated, and telling people that the narrative of aggregated data is not the same, that the community level data is able to.
So I got two questions for you, David. You know that the Fiscal Oversight Board has a revitalization coordinator. Has he met with the planners? What's the story here?
In short, no. Well, let me put it this way. Back in December, I was on a panel with the governor and the CIO, the Chief Information Officer, in the same panel. And they started the conversation saying that they talked with everyone, and they didn't talk with the planners.
Okay.
And we were talking about planning.
Right. Okay.
So the narrative of the government, especially with investors, is that Puerto Rico is a blank slate.
Okay.
And that you can go to Puerto Rico and do whatever you want.
Okay.
But we have plans. We have a lot of literature on what should be done, how it should be done. And
we have actual plans, like the Puerto Rico land use plan, and many municipalities that have the fifth hierarchy where they have municipal plans and, you know, they can effect permits and all that.
It's really important to have into consideration that we are now in a process of amendments to the general code.
Right.
And through that amendments, they're trying to eliminate the hierarchies.
Really?
All of them. They are going to eliminate.
That's a huge mistake, by the way.
They are going to eliminate the validity of municipal codes, just going all of them to the general code. That eliminates the practical use of planning at a local level.
So we have a few questions from the audience. Ma'am?
Yeah, I'm Jerry Hush, and I actually just gave a talk on Action Insights. I'm a consultant to Centro.
Can you speak louder, please?
Yeah, I was just going to say that
again
here. My name is Jerry Hush, and I'm a sociologist, and I just gave a talk on Action Insights. I'm a consultant to Centro, and I want to really have people know that Centro has hired me to work on a way to code data so that we can strengthen partnerships and alliances. And we were just in here. So that Centro is part of an innovation group that's working to bring in data from a variety of sources so that the planning opportunities, and especially an alternative vision of what is an appropriate plan, that we can capture data from the community that historically has not been captured before. So it's that you were also in the talk. It is a method, and we're trying with the Centro to build a platform that will allow people in the community to very quickly see who is doing what, where can you gain support, and designed to be visual. So I really want people to know that Centro, if you're interested in this, talk to people at Centro and to really build. We're going to be in Puerto Rico on the 15th at the next conference, and we're going to be doing community training for capturing data across the island. Again, it's a very innovative, it's called Action Insights. I work with the UN, and this method was used across Africa for climate change adaptation. So it's a way to bring in multiple resources very, very quickly to support the planning activities.
Thank you so much. Oh, yeah.
I want to really make sure that I have a good idea of the timeline on where we are. Although this is going to be awesome in the long term, we have 14 days, and we are on the day 2 or 3 of those 14 days to comment on the action plan of housing. And
I'm sorry, what was that?
On Thursday, it was published the action plan for housing for allocating $1.5 billion on the island. So we have like 12 days training to comment on that.
So we need all of you to come.
Where do we go to comment?
You go to ir.
So perhaps El Centro can provide that link so people can access it.
Yes, exactly. Right.
Right.
And I'm sorry, but this has to be.
So this is Sandra Rodriguez. Go ahead.
Yeah, I'm just saying that
louder, please.
People need to know this, and I might suggest to be, if it's not your organization, but I think the organization would be even better in Puerto Rico to issue a press release or to issue a statement because nobody knows about this.
Exactly. We are on it.
Yeah, so Sandra is a great colleague and awesome friend. We've known each other for a long, long time. So Sandra could be very instrumental. She's available to help you guys out.
Can that announcement or press conference in some abbreviated form out to us so that we can paste it in Facebook?
Of course. Yes, sir.
I have a question, and it's twofold. Do you feel that the problems have been correctly identified?
That's a question for Ivis and the panelists. So yes. Go ahead.
And I'm asking that question because I spent from 2006 to 2013, my time in Puerto Rico, and that was my retirement, that was the dream of my life, et cetera, et cetera. And it's not the same place where I was born. Mm-hmm. The moral fabric has been destroyed. Consumerism has taken over. And nobody's questioning that in Puerto Rico. And the question that I'm asking is this, because I met somebody, a young man running for office, who was asked, you know, what is your background? Oh, I have a degree from Phoenix University, distance learning. The University of Puerto Rico, I've always asked myself, when distance learning came about, which was a long time ago, back in the 90s. Mm-hmm. Why didn't the University of Puerto Rico adopt distance learning when there were 50 million Hispanics here, most of them didn't know English, who could have benefited from that? Can you answer that?
Well, they don't work for the University of Puerto Rico.
Well,
we don't want to get Carmen in trouble.
The reason, you know, like I said, Puerto Rico is not the place where I'm in a little different society.
Right.
And this is a blessing in disguise. Yeah, just open up. Right? Mm-hmm. Because it was easy for anyone to become chancellor as long as he was affiliated with the ruling party at the moment. Or it was very easy to become a school principal. 50%, I was talking to a school principal there. Mm-hmm. Only 50% of the staff employed by the Board of Education of Puerto Rico was sitting in an office collecting a check as a supervisor. Mm-hmm. 50% of the staff. Right, because of, you know, the political corruption.
Right. So the fundamental problems in Puerto Rico. We're trying to discuss community planning issues, which education is obviously a community planning issue, but we'd like to gravitate towards that. So, please.
Yeah, mi nombre es Julián Ponte. Yo soy planificador también arquitecto. Have you been contacted or working with Planes Network?
I listen, you guys can answer that.
Are they being of any help? Because theoretically, that's a progressive wing of the APA.
Yes. Yeah. I've been in contact with, like, everything in Puerto Rico, it's become really complicated because assigning tasks for people is become a task. So, for example, with not only with our planners network, but also with the APA, we've been trying to make deals with the mayors in order to make mitigation plans or other planning tools that they need. But it really becomes complicated because of logical details. Bringing them here, explaining the local context.
Because I will go, yeah, I've been in front of the center for many years. And I just retired from UMass Boston.
Awesome.
And I've been looking at, talking to Ed, I was here, about somehow involving even students to do things, but I don't want to rush that because I did do that when I was a civic college, and it's very complicated. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it overstresses the receiving community. So,
right.
But anyhow, But I would like to communicate so that I can be of help in those connections, because I, even though I'm not officially part of Flash Network, I am an old fart from the past.
So we got two last questions, so we can wrap this up.
But I would say that even though we're not still at a project level, every experience that you have from past disaster sites always helps.
Right. Yes, sir.
Yeah, El Nuevo Día and other papers in Puerto Rico did a series of articles on the number of buildings that were built recently. This is before Maria, Puerto Rico. Many of them completed, but abandoned. Hundreds of buildings throughout. Then they also did a series of articles on the hundreds of buildings in Santurce, all along Avenida Ponce de León. And the conclusion that they left the reader with was that there are no planners. It's like anarchy.
So
actually, that inventory done by planner.
The inventory of abandoned buildings.
Yes.
So, yeah. Ma'am.
You know, given the devastation that Maria, ended up, you know, resulted in, obviously, you know, some analysis probably has been taken in terms of the structures, you know, because even the cement structures, you know, the houses that were made of cement, you know, were destroyed. So, you know, how does with the new planning, you know, how does that affect how homes will be structured in the future?
Good question. All right, so we got an architect here, perhaps can answer that question.
In Puerto Rico, do you have the building code? It's the same code that in the United States. But the problem is the poor people do not have money to contract an architect or an engineer and go to the permit office to submit the permits. The poor people in the rural areas or in the poor area of the city auto-contract your house. This is the reality. Puerto Rico, 42% of the family are below poverty level. That means that it's necessary that government have a political or public policies about housing in the poor community. Exactly. This is the big problem.
I mean, but I mean, if people go ahead and, let's say, construct a home without going through the proper channels, you know, the same, you know, like here, you get, I mean, you know, you get fined and you have to register the home and there has to be signatures of an engineer.
No, true. I worked here in New York City many years.
I think that with this topic,
I don't know, you know, I always lived in a private home, my, you know, my family, and anything that had to be done, you know, had to go through the private channel.
I think that with this topic, we can answer actually your question, and yours. In Puerto Rico, it's not that we don't have planning. It's that we don't have a regulation for the real estate market. And the promise that the ELA made back in the 50s, what did not include the 53% that had to go to the rural areas to live with outside the system. So what we should be talking about in the future of planning for Puerto Rico is how to make that city, that promise that you make to all Puerto Ricans, available for all Puerto Ricans, not only to the percent that owns them.
To the market sector, or the people in the market sector.
Okay, Javier.
I cannot agree more with what David just expressed. I think that Maria was an atmospheric system that passed by and caused a lot of damage. And this is a reality. We've been seeing the consequences, but for more than 10 years, there's been a system in Puerto Rico that it's been affecting the destruction of the fabric of a lot of communities and families. Mm-hmm. And that's a problem of housing, not at the poor, traditional poor level that what we're referring as social housing, mm-hmm. but middle-income people, it's been affected by banks and that foreclosure processes. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I mean, when we're talking about thousands of people that are being losing their houses because there's no regulation regarding those processes, injustices are being caused across. And this is something that is going on right now. It's been in place for more than 10 years. And nobody, no institution, no private sector, not NGOs are being addressing seriously this issue. I mean, when we look at those maps of people moving from Puerto Rico to the US, we're not just looking at people that moved because they were affected by Maria. They've been affected by a process that is being and it's been displacing people. And Ella put in place for many families. It's in the genetic of the families in Puerto Rico, aspiring for a home, aspiring for a place to live, a decent place to live. And that issue, it's when you put a home out of a family, you're taking everything. And they, I mean, there's a some, there's, I mean, I've been very close in my family. I've been, actually, we live this in many members of our community. Everyone is underestimated. I think we cannot build community. We cannot be talking about developing community if we change the one that we have right now. And that starts addressing this issue will help us.
So Javier, just so people know who you are, please introduce yourself.
I'm Javier Jesus. I'm an architect, but I'm right now working at the Universidad of Corazon as an innovation center director. So yeah, I was a former advisor to the governor in urban SME infrastructure and environment. And those who know these people.
A great friend of ours. Well, I got one more question, sir.
I have two concerns, and they all have to do with the same thing. I am not of the diaspora. I was 38 years ago. I returned home when I was 27. I lived here for 23 years. My family totally lives here. I am a Catholic priest, and I am living in. I was 6 months. So, being a professional, I mean, all of your different, but I know, and I live, that for the first few weeks, they did whatever they wanted to do, put some lighting up on San Juan and some of the areas near San Juan, but the rest of us were not even considered, and we asked. I went through that 6 months. I had a prisoner commit suicide. From one of the urbanizations next door to us, they put a mother-daughter combo, femo. The mother had emphysema, diabetes, and I think a little dementia. The girl was paraplegic. And I spent weeks buying water, coffee, milk for them until one night the girl was charging her phone. She was using it at the same time. She went to sleep, and she got burned. Second degree burns on her body. Her mother inhaled all the
oh my God.
And so they were for weeks in the hospital. I know that, excuse me, to the journalists, the too many sensationalist stories came out on the news. Few people went, for instance, to El Barrio San Salvador in Caguas, where they just got light last week. Or to Ciales, that was destroyed in an unbelievable way. Are we really going to ask those people what they need? Because the government there didn't do it. Trump's throwing of bounties in Guaynabo didn't do it. Mm-hmm. And I'm not, I was a Sagrado Corazon as a teacher, prof. I am still active as a Catholic priest, but I represent the people. And nobody is listening enough to us. So if Centro is going to get involved, I invite Centro not to listen to the municipalities, because unfortunately the socio-political situation in Puerto Rico is still that of 35 years ago. Padrinaco, compadraco. I suggest that Centro get some contacts on the island, excuse me, and it should be through the University of Puerto Rico. The architect. It should be. And do something with the people. And then you can get the planners and everybody else involved. But if the people don't, culturally, we have hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of situations where abuelo gave four different tracts of land to their grandchildren. Houses were built. The great-grandchildren now have the houses. They have no papers.
Yeah.
And so culturally, FEMA doesn't understand that. You don't deserve anything. But what happens to those families? Three families living in a one-story building? You've got a lot of work to do. We say on the island, it's going to take us 10 years.
So, Padre, what's the one thing that we can do right now as planners for people on the ground?
Get communication going, get it going fast. If you don't know what's going to come, look what happened. We lost all cell phone usage for weeks, months. So we didn't know what was going on in FEMA saying, go to .com. Hello. We have no electricity. We have no cell phones. We have not. Some of us didn't even have a radio.
So infrastructure.
Infrastructure.
But energy and telecommunications.
But you got to get to the people,
right?
Not just to municipalities.
Community-based projects. Like, I mean, I'm sorry.
What's your name, please?
I'm Ms. Salinas, from Santiago. And I think that what we saw after Hurricane Maria was that the community spontaneously doing things for themselves, because you know the government response was not coming quickly enough. And I think now that we have to prepare for the second hurricane, upcoming hurricane season, that people desperately, and especially people with special medical needs, they need at least a minimal amount of energy and maybe something like solar kits on rooftops, or especially those people with so much.
Can I just add something? They sent that bill. The government said you needed a referral from your doctor, and they said you can just come. Of course, most of us didn't know because we had no telecommunications.
I don't want to repeat what I said yesterday on the panel, but I was the day, my name is Sandra Rodriguez, and the day after the hurricane, even with the winds and the rain, I went to the Papagayo. Life, and I spent 4 months working as a volunteer on that station, because it was the only place where we could at least have some sort of communication with people. And we had lines of 400, 500 people around the station coming from different areas. Sometimes they were walking. People came, at least I handled 8 phone calls of people who called saying that they were going to commit suicide. Lady that came with dishes and was a victim of domestic violence. There was another lady who called on the radio because there was no police station near her home. The she was hiding from her husband who was trying to kill her, and a nun heard that story on the station. And I don't know how she was able to remember that woman, and that happened. And I mean, there's so much we can do. And as I said, I did it. I understand why you went through, Father, because I also went through that, and I heard all the stories. And at this moment, what my concern with the media in Puerto Rico and with the communications is that people are not hearing what is really going on. I mean, it's good that the planners are trying to plan, but the people at the base, they don't know anything. And the people that control the media are aligned with the government and with FEMA and also with the planning board, and they have, they're controlling the public opinion. You have comics on the radio, talking on the radio, like Jorge de Castro Pon. I mean, if the center is going to do something, it has to go deep into the society and try to change the narrative. And I couldn't agree more.
We're still being told 64 people died because of the hurricane.
Yeah.
We in the island, that's what we're told.
Yeah.
And it's over 1,000 last count.
You know, there's an organization that was started by a group of young adults, and it's called La Mañara. And they do exactly what they do. They come into the different community. What's that? Can you say the name? La Mañana. La Mañana. Thank you. I knew it. I was trying to get it from my phone because I can't get Wi-Fi. And they actually do exactly what you just stated. They go into the communities. They work with the community. They ask them, what is it that they need? What is it that they would like? And then they train them and help them get started, and it's been, I mean, from 5-year-olds all the way to the elderly, a part of rebuilding their communities. You know, if you know anything more about it, please, you know, add to it, because it, you know, it addresses exactly what he is saying.
The thing is that the government in Puerto Rico was not allowed
All right, so I think we're out of time. Yeah. This has been a great conversation. I'd like to thank everyone here today. Just stick around in terms of connecting with what El Centro is doing and us with the American Planning Association and the Puerto Rican Society of Planners. Federico, pleasure again. Ibis, Carmen, awesome. And David, and Sandra, and all you guys. Thank you so much.
You're right.